Welcome to Let the Quran Speak. I'm Safiya, your host. There are many Muslim children's stories out there, but are they any good? Here to discuss with me the quality of Islamic children's literature, we have Rukhsana Khan. She is the award-winning author of 12 books. One of these books, The Big Red Lollipop, is included on the New York Public Library's list of 100 great children's books of the last 100 years. What sort of books do Muslim children need to read? What sort of books do others need to read about Muslims? Why are these books in such short supply? And how can an author write about religious values while producing stories that are celebrated in the mainstream? Rukhsana, thanks so much for being on the show.
Oh, thank you for having me.
Now, I want to talk about the state of Muslim children's literature. I grew up in Canada, so I had access, we had access to many, many books. I went to the library, we borrowed many books. And my parents tried to make sure that we also had as many children's, Muslim children's books as possible. So they bought everything that was available. And some of it was pretty horrendous.
It still is.
I must say that when I saw your writings, I was so pleasantly surprised and impressed to see that this quality of writing was available. But you are still an exception, I find.
Yeah.
So can you maybe talk about what's available out there?
Okay, well, in terms of what's available right now, growing up there was like almost nothing. And whatever Muslim books you found, you just bought it. Because, you know, beggars can't be choosers, so you just have to find it. Nowadays, there are actually quite a few Muslim authors coming up. One of them I'm going to be meeting actually on next Friday, Nahid Senzai. She's got a husband who's from Afghanistan. I would call it more like secular Muslim. Like there's all kinds of Muslim books. Mm-hmm. There's Muslim books where the stories are more from a religious perspective. Mm-hmm. Like mine are more like that. And then there's more the secular type. And actually on my website, I have a Muslim book list. These are books that I approve of. You know, there's not that many books on there. And some of the books aren't even that great, but because I couldn't find anything wrong with them, I put them up because a lot of times educators are asking me, you know, what kind of books are out there for the Muslims in their classrooms. Mm-hmm. So there are books out there right now.
So what are your criterion for a good book for Muslim children?
It's got to be a good story. If it's not a good story, it's not a good book.
Yeah.
Okay, and there's a lot of horrendous books.
There
and
are.
In fact, sometimes the authors would ask me to include a book on the list. One for instance, they recently asked me to include this book, and I just looked at it and I thought, oh my goodness, and it's about this really really secular Muslim, and the funny thing is like, in terms of Muslim literature, it seems to be all about Ramadan. Like all the mainstream publishers are just writing about Ramadan because mm-hmm. that's what people know about.
Yeah,
and they kind of respect.
My son is 16 months and he already has 3 Ramadan
books. I know. How many Ramadan books do you want, right? And even in Muslim Child, I have a Ramadan story and I have, but that's okay. Like, and some of the Ramadan stories are okay, but to me personally, if I was a kid, I don't think I would want to read them.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem I had was this. I think sometimes like secular Muslims are looking at writing about Ramadan as a way to get published. And there was one story, I'm not even going to mention the title, but it's a story about a girl who wants to fast because she thinks she'll lose weight and so she can fit into a bikini. SubhanAllah. I mean, and of course, this is the kind of book that a lot of non-Muslims would think, oh, this is fantastic. And I thought, no. Yeah, so there's a lot of, and that book is not on my list. But instead of the books on my list, there are some really good authors. One of them, I really like her name, is Naima Bint Robert. But actually, the best product that she's got is a sister's magazine. But she does also children's books as well. And one of them in particular, I thought Swirling the Hijab is really nice. And she has Ramadan Moon and some of the Ramadan books and Hajj and everything. So there are some authors coming out. In terms of, there's also one in Australia who's been very popular. Her name is Randa Abdel Fattah. And she wrote, Oh, Does My Head Look Big in This?
Mm-hmm.
And
I heard
it's
of that book.
Yeah, it's the first book that actually became kind of an international bestseller. And it's about a girl who wants to wear hijab. And the nice thing about the book, I really thought, was the fact that while you're reading the book, you are actually rooting for her to wear hijab.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I mean, Muslim women get so much judgment about the hijab, and it. But honestly, it bugs me the fact that Randa Abdel Fattah took it off. She doesn't wear it, and I'm thinking, okay, that kind of undermines the message of the book. But alhamdulillah, it's still a good book, and she's written some other books like Where the Streets Had a Name, and that one's in Palestine. Very good. She's like Palestinian or Lebanese or something like that. So she's quite a well-recognized author. So there are some other authors out there. In terms of North America, I think I'm actually still at one of the top in terms of the Muslim authors. Mm-hmm. But I got my sights set even higher. I don't want to just be a good Muslim author. I want to be like one of the best authors.
All right. Okay, yeah. I think you're heading there.
Inshallah, I'm trying.
So where do we get these books? Because I mean, as my son grows older, I'm looking for books, but I have no idea where to find them. I found a few on Amazon, but yeah. You know, where do you find these books?
Well, the best thing to do to get the books.
I found horrible ones at Islamic bookstores. I know. So I should mention that.
The Islamic bookstores, they go for cheap. Okay, they want the cheap books.
Yeah, they don't rhyme. You know? The rhyming is horrible.
Oh my gosh,
there's spelling mistakes.
If you can't rhyme, don't rhyme. Just write the story. Don't rhyme. You know, don't. The best way to get them really is through the through online. Mm-hmm. And Amazon has all my books. Okay, and also I think Chapters. If you order, you go into a Chapter store, they won't have it. Mm-hmm. But you go to Amazon online, or even just go to my website, RukhsanaKhan.com, and click on Buy the Book. I even have links to the other books on my book list. So you can get any of the books from through online.
What is your advice for somebody, let's say a Muslim, who wants to write stories for children?
Hard question? It's not hard, it's kind of tedious. Every week I get like a question. Yeah, I get, and after I do a session, people come up to me and they say, and the thing is sometimes...
Some people think it's really easy to write a Muslim children's book, so they just think, oh, I can make easy money, I can do this. It's just a few words, few words on a page.
actually, I find the picture books, the short books, are the hardest to write. Big Red Lollipop is the one that got on the New York Public Library
list of 20 books.
100 greatest children's books in the last 100 years.
Yeah.
That took me 10 years to write, okay? Wow. So a lot of people think the short ones are easy. I thought so too, but they're actually the hardest. To distill a story, a really good story, into such short words is really hard. I would question people in terms of you want to become an author, especially these days. It's really hard to make it. Oh my goodness, it's really hard.
It took a while for you to get published.
Yeah, it took me 8 years to get my first book published, and I've been at this now for 26 years. So now my stories are starting to get noticed. Mm-hmm. It took that long, but you have to really love the process, and you have to think, what am I trying to add to the discourse? Are you just going to write a story to get published, to become someone, for your ego, for your glory, for your fame? Because really, there's better ways of getting famous or something like that. You know, if you want to add to the discourse, if you have something important to say, then pursue it, because it's going to take patience and it's going to take perseverance. And you have to leave your ego, check it at the door, because really, it's ultimately about what the story is going to say. And personally, I want my stories to earn me reward with Allah, with God, not just in this life, but in the hereafter. When I'm in the grave, if people can get some good, some benefit from my stories, it's going to be cha-ching, cha-ching, you know, like I'm going to be getting some reward in the hereafter too, and that's what I'm working for. Mm-hmm. So if you're trying to become an author, ask yourself, is it for the ego? Because it's going to be hard. Mm-hmm. It's not going to be easy. And if you think your family is going to support you and buy your books, no, they're going to expect them as gifts. Okay, you're going to want buying them and giving them as gifts. Well, alhamdulillah, who cares, really? You don't want family to support you. You want the general public to support you.
I want to ask you a question about what it means for a book to be Islamic. I mean, can you just say that any mainstream book that has religious values or, you know, Islamic sort of values is Islamic, or do you think it should be explicitly Islamic?
Oh, well, to be Islamic, I would say it has to deal in some way with either being Muslim or being or Islam, you know.
Yeah, I guess my question is how do you avoid a heavy-handed approach Islam? Because I have noticed that a lot of books do fall into that trap.
Well, I did too at the beginning.
Okay.
I would stick a moral at the end. Oh my gosh, no, don't do that. Let it weave itself into the story. Let it be, let the moral or the good, the message that you're trying to say, or even the Islamic message, let it come through in the story. Mm-hmm. You know, like with Big Red Lollipop, the message is is not just about forgiveness, it's about sharing. There's so many things in there. And it comes through the story. It's a natural result of what the characters are like and what they're doing. Mm-hmm. So you can't, and that's what I
think. Part of it is understanding or trusting that a child has intelligence to be able to discern the message, you know, through the book.
Actually, it's funny because when I'm writing, I don't even think of the child.
You don't think of the child?
Oh, no, I just think of the characters. Okay. What are the characters going to do? And the thing is, the characters are kind of set. Like, if you try to force them to do something that they're not, it's not within their character mm-hmm. to naturally do, the story's not going to work. It's going to be clunky. It's going to be horrible. So you have to tease it out of them and get them to do what you want, or even just change the story. I think eventually your own morals and things will come through in the story. I don't even try to work too hard to make the story something moralistic or Islamic. It's just generally going to come through because that's who I am mm-hmm. and it's from where I'm coming from.
Mm-hmm. How is it possible to write a book that, you know, has religious undertones but is still celebrated in the mainstream, like your books?
Well, it's funny because with Wanting More, I wrote that story. It's about a girl whose mother dies during the war in Afghanistan. It's set in Afghanistan. She wears the Purani. She actually wears the face cover and she wants to wear it. And her mother dies during the war. Father gets remarried. Stepmother doesn't want her. So the father takes her to the marketplace and he leaves her there. And she ends up in an orphanage that I sponsored a library in from the money from my book, The Roses in My Carpets. When I was writing that book, I thought, who the heck is ever going to read this book? This girl is way too Muslim, way too Islamic. That story ended up being shortlisted for about 15 different awards around
wow.
the world.
That's amazing.
Yeah, and the funny thing is, it was sold in Japan, Australia, New Zealand, Italy. It sold so well. I went there and I launched the book. Where else? In India. All non-Muslim countries, okay, at first. And now, it's been bought by Sharjah, which is one of the UAE countries. Mm-hmm. So finally, it's going to be in Arabic. And this is, in fact, when my husband read it, he said, I can't believe a non-Muslim publisher published it. And the publisher that published it is one of the best publishers in Canada, Groundwood. They published this book, and they loved it. They said that we got to publish it, because they had also done the Breadwinner series, and this is almost the other side of it. And so when you write a story that's really true, that's true to the person, it will cross those racial, ethnic, cultural barriers. It will cross those barriers. And the funny thing is, I mean, the head of the Toronto Children's Book Children's Services, he's gay. He loved it. Mm-hmm. My daughters, they're very strict. They loved it. Mm-hmm. Two of them wear niqab. Very strict Muslims. They loved it. My Jewish Zionist friend loved it. You know, like, all these different people loved it. And the lady in Italy, my host, she was a librarian. She said, she was an atheist. And she said, you know, this book touched me like no other book touched me. And so when you write the truth, and if you write it convincingly and beautifully, then it will cross. It will cross people and touch people.
Rukhsana, that's all the time we have. Thank you so much for appearing on our show.
Really appreciate that. Thank you for having me.